Hello everyone. Welcome back to our channel. Today we will talk about how to read and check strand stressing record. We hope it can benefit all the engineers who are involved in assessing stressing record submitted by the specialist contractor. Before that, please help us to subscribe, like and share our channel with your engineering friends. Stressing jack is a mechanical device used to pull the strand. Inside the jack, wedges are used to grip and hold the strand during stressing works. The jack is normally operated using a hydraulic pressure to push the ram, hence pulling the strand. Then, the strand elongation can be measured from the jack extended stroke. Before we start checking on the stressing record, we will show you the types of hydraulic stressing jack used at site. There are two types of stressing jack, namely mono jack and multi jack. A mono jack is used to stress a single strand one at a time, whereas a multi jack is used to stress a higher number of strands per tendon. All the strands are stressed simultaneously in a bundle. The first item to check in any stressing record is the serial number of the pressure gauge and stressing jack. Both the pressure gauge and stressing jack serial numbers must be the same as the ones recorded in the stressing record. Next, identify the jack stroke length and compare it with the theoretical elongation. If the stroke length is more than the theoretical elongation, no reset in recording is required. If the stroke length is less than the theoretical elongation, reset in recording is required. We need to ensure the correct jack capacity is used for stressing work. The jack capacity should be more than the design stressing force in one pull. Countercheck the strand diameter as the strand breaking load varies according to its diameter. Lastly, identify the jacking pressure according to the number and diameter of the strand. This is very important to avoid applying the wrong pulling force. Later in our video, for the mono jack, we will only be touching on the part where the gripping block is located at jack nose. The elongation recorded is based on one end stressing and before lock off. Please ensure all the required information are correct and legit. Project name and type of structure must be filled by the operator. Beam or slab marking is needed for identification. Ensure that the date of stressing is correct. Ensure that the pressure gauge and stressing jack serial number tallies with the calibration certificate and actual machine used at site. Before the commencing work, please make sure that the theoretical elongation falls under either before lock-off or after lock-off. It must be the same as to what will be recorded at site. Lastly, make sure the concrete has achieved its design transfer strength before stressing. It can be verified by conducting a compressive cube test on the concrete. First of all, make sure the tendon marking and number of strand follows the approved shop drawing. To start off, apply a preliminary force to eliminate the take-up in the tensioning system. This preliminary force will be in the range of 5% to 25% of the final jacking force. At least 3 readings are required for the operator to check the elongation in 2 intervals during recording. Whenever required, the operator can plot an elongation versus force graph and check for the linearity of the plotted line. If the line is straight, the strand is still in elastic state. After completion of the full stressing force, we have only recorded the elongation between the preliminary and final jacking force. In fact, our recordings at site should start from zero pressure. We can hereby extrapolate the reading by taking the difference in elongation measurement and divide by pressure difference. The red arrow represent elongation and the green arrow representing pressure. Then, multiply with the full stressing force and we will get the corrected elongation value. As mentioned earlier, using a mono jack will only permit the stressing to be done strand by strand. Therefore, all the elongation from each strand and the same tendon will be averaged up in representing the tendon elongation. Next, calculate the percentage of deviated elongation from the recordings at site with calculated theoretical value. The percentage becomes part of the verification done by the designer and operator in applying tensioning force considering all the relevant short-term losses. Same applies to mono jack with reset stroke. We just need to identify reset jacking pressure in the record. Normally, the pressure can be reset at approximately half of final jacking force. Once the stressing pressure reaches the reset value, the operator needs to measure the stroke and record it down under box A. Release pressure to retract the stroke. Then reset the jack stroke and start stressing again until it reaches reset pressure. Measure the stroke length as a new benchmark and record it down under box B. Then, continue stressing up to the final force and record the elongation. After completing the full stressing force, we have only recorded elongation in between the preliminary and final jacking force. In fact, our recording at site should start from zero pressure. We can hereby extrapolate the reading for the first reset bracket by taking the difference in the elongation measurement and divide by pressure difference. The red arrow represent elongation and the green arrow representing pressure. Then, multiply with reset stressing force and we will get the corrected elongation value. After that, we will need to add up the elongation in the second reset bracket that occurred from resetting the pressure to the final jacking force. Elongation recorded in second part do not need to be extrapolated again. It is mainly due to the fact that no take-up in tensioning system after correction has been made in the first recording. Similarly to monojack without reset, all the elongation from each strand and the same tendon will be averaged up to represent the tendon elongation. Calculate percentage of deviated elongation from the recordings at site with the calculated theoretical value. This percentage becomes part of the verification by the designer and operator in applying tensioning force considering all the relevant short-term losses. For with and without reset stroke, we will always need to check the recorded wedge and value. If the designer considered 6 mm wedge in the design calculation, then the recorded wedge in needs to be same or less than 6 mm. If it is more than 6 mm, justification from the tensioning system supplier is needed. Now, let's start with multi-jack without reset. Make sure the tendon marking and number of strand follows the approved shop drawing. For multi-jack stressing record, there is only one set of data for each tendon. This is due to the fact that all strands are stressed simultaneously. Similar to mono-jack stressing, apply preliminary force to eliminate take-up in the tensioning system. This preliminary force will be in the range of 5% to 25% of the final jacking force. Equal interval force measurements are required for the operator to check the elongation during recording. In this sample, the interval is set to 1,000 pounds per square inch. Whenever required, the operator can plot an elongation versus force graph and check for the linearity of the plotted line. If the line is straight, the strand is still in elastic state. After completing the full stressing force, we have only recorded the elongation in between the preliminary and final jacking force. In fact, our recording at site should start from zero pressure. We can hereby extrapolate the readings by taking the difference in elongation measurement and divide by with pressure difference. The red arrow represent elongation and the green arrow representing pressure. Then, multiply with full stressing force and we will get the corrected elongation value. Calculate the percentage of deviated elongation from the recorded at site with the calculated theoretical value. This percentage becomes part of verification by the designer and operator in applying tensioning force considering all the relevant short-term losses. Remember that for final calculated elongation before lock-off, we need to minus the elongation within jack body. Same applies to the multi-jack with reset stroke. We just need to identify the reset jacking pressure in the record. Normally, the pressure can be reset at approximately half of final jacking force. Once the stressing pressure reaches its reset value, the operator needs to measure stroke and record it down and under box A. Release pressure to retract the stroke. Then reset the jack stroke and start stressing again until reaching the reset pressure. Measure the stroke length as a new benchmark and record it down under box B. Continue stressing up to the final force and record the elongation. After completing the full stressing force, we have only recorded the elongation in between the preliminary and final jacking force. In fact, our recording at site should start from zero pressure. We can hereby extrapolate the reading for the first reset bracket by taking the difference in elongation measurement and divide by pressure difference. The red arrow represent elongation and the green arrow representing pressure. Then, multiply with the reset stressing force and we will get the corrected elongation value. After that, we will need to add up the elongation in the second reset bracket occurred from the reset pressure to final jacking force. Elongation recorded in the second part do not need to be extrapolated again. It is mainly due to the fact that no take-up in tensioning system after correction has been made in the first recording. Calculate the percentage of deviated elongation from the recordings at site with the calculated theoretical value. This percentage becomes part of verification by the designer and operator in applying tensioning force considering all the relevant short-term losses. Remember that for final calculated elongation before lock-off, we need to minus elongation within jack body. For with and without stroke reset, we always need to check for the recorded participated wedge in value. If the designer considered 6 mm wedge in the design calculation, then the recorded wedge needs to be the same or less than 6 mm. If it is more than 6 mm, justification from the tensioning system supplier is needed. What is the difference between before lock-off and after lock-off in recording? For before lock-off, you can measure elongation at jack stroke during stressing works. Whereas for after lock-off, measurement can be done at strand using paint as marker after removal of jack. Counter check on wedge in is needed after release of pressure and before lock-off. However, for after lock-off, wedge in can't be measured as it's happened after the release of jacking pressure. In before lock-off, we need to minus out elongation within jack body. But for multi-jack, it can be ignored in after lock-off recording. Here are several important notes to share. First, concrete strength needs to achieve the minimum initial strength specified in design specification. Second, stressing tools are calibrated with valid certificate. Third, stressing works to be operated by competent personnel. Fourth, inspection is done by monitoring pressure gauge reading and no drop in pressure reading during holding. Fifth, measurement of elongation to be read as accurately as possible. Sixth, acceptance of percentage of deviation in elongation to refer to approved method statement. Lastly, summary of stressing record needs to be approved by the designer before cutting of strand at site. That's all for today. Thanks for watching and following us. We see you again in the next video. Bye.